question of a nose case. In your ENT exam, most likely the nose case which comes is can be a DNS, can be allergic rhinitis, can be nasal polyps. So we'll discuss the case of a deviated nasal septum. You start the case.
Patient Mr. Udham Sawar, residing in Dairi, 18 years of age, lumbar occupation, came with chief complaints of nasal obstruction since 3 to 4 years, recurrent rhinitis since 3 to 4 years, and on and off headache since 3 to 4 years.
So we have a patient who is 18 years old who has mainly 3 complaints. What are the 3 complaints?
Nasal obstruction, nasal
rhinitis, headache. So nasal obstruction, rhinitis and headache. Okay. History of presenting illness.
History of presenting illness. The patient was apparently alright 3 to 4 years back when he developed nasal obstruction, which was on the left side. It was a partial block, non-progressive. It increased more during episodes of rhinitis. It was aggravated during seasonal changes, relieved partially with topical drops and some medication by local doctor.
So whenever you describe nasal obstruction, you should have these 3 or 4 points to mention. That is the site, the duration of obstruction, the site of obstruction, whether it is complete or partial, whether it is progressive or constant, and aggravating relieving factors. So these 5 points have to be discussed when you discuss nasal obstruction. Can anyone tell me causes of one-sided nasal obstruction?
Nasal polyps.
Which polyps?
Antropoid.
Okay, foreign body, mass, anything else?
Sinusitis.
One side sinusitis. DNS. Okay, so common causes for one-sided nasal obstruction will be DNS is the most common. In a child, it can be foreign body, it can be one-sided malignancy, it can be antroponial polyp. Remember, antroponial polyp is one-sided, ethmoidal polyps are bilateral. And what are causes for bilateral obstruction? Anything? Adenoid can cause, yes, adenoid can cause a nasopharyngeal block and can cause bilateral obstruction, ethmoid polyps, anything else?
DNS
can cause bilateral obstruction in which way?
S-shaped
DNS can cause bilateral obstruction. Second is, if a patient has a C-shaped DNS, along with that DNS, if the patient has opposite side turbinate hypertrophy, it is called as paradoxical turbinate hypertrophy. Even in that case, you will have bilateral nasal obstruction. So you should be prepared with one-sided obstruction causes. You should be prepared with bilateral nasal obstruction causes. Okay, further history.
The patient also complained of recurrent rhinitis since 3 to 4 years. It was mostly mucoid, occasional mucopurulent discharge from both sides. It was aggravated during seasonal changes and relieved on topical drops.
So whenever you describe nasal discharge, it should be the, as you rightly described, it should be quality of discharge. The moment you say mucopurulent, what does it signify?
Bacterial
infection. Meaning, where is it coming from? More likely diagnosis should be sinusitis. In case of allergic rhinitis or viral rhinitis, the discharge will be plain mucoid kind of discharge. The moment pus starts coming, it becomes mucopurulent, think that patient has got bacterial infection, patient is having a bacterial rhinitis or a sinusitis. What is the discharge in allergic rhinitis?
Watery
kind of discharge. Remember, watery discharge is seen in allergic rhinitis and in CSF. You should be aware about common points by which we differentiate allergic rhinitis discharge from a CSF discharge. Okay, further history.
The patient complained of on and off headache and facial pain, which was more on the left side. It was aggravated during attack of rhinitis and relieved on taking analgesics.
So what does this kind of headache signify, which is a facial pain?
Sinusitis.
The patient has one-sided obstruction, patient has that same side facial pain. Remember, a facial pain is typical significant of sinusitis. A temporal pain of one side can be migraine, can be a cluster headache. Cluster headache is more likely a central part of headache. Migraine is one side of pain. And what if a patient says he has occipital headache, what can be the cause?
Hypertension.
What else about in ENT? A localized sphenoid sinus involvement. A sphenoid sinusitis, the patient will have occipital headache. Okay, so occipital headache, as you rightly said, most common is hypertension, but a young age person, think in terms of sphenoid sinusitis also. But generalized sinusitis, patient will have a facial kind of pain, or frontofacial pain is a term commonly used. Okay, further.
Negative history. No complaints of recurrent sneezing, itching in nose, no epistaxis.
Why did you ask for recurrent sneezing? what do you want to rule out?
Allergic
rhinitis. Okay. Same for itching. Allergic rhinitis should have 4 or 5 symptoms. One is recurrent sneezing, itching, itching of the redness of the eyes, itching of the palate, and watery discharge. So red eye, congestion, itching of the palate, watery discharge, nasal obstruction, sneezing are symptoms of allergic rhinitis. Okay.
No epistaxis, no snoring or mouth breathing, no ear pain, no discharge or reduced hair.
Okay, you should be aware about common causes for epistaxis. Remember, you just have those 7 to 8 minutes to face the examiner. In this 7 to 8 minutes, you will be asked not only that question, but questions of general topic also. So the moment you say no epistaxis, you should be aware of common causes for epistaxis. It can be, what are common causes?
Trauma.
Trauma is most important. Then? Like?
Hypertension.
Or? Bleeding disorder for diabetes. Hypertension can be caused. There can be bleeding disorders. There can be trauma is the most common cause. DNS, sinusitis per se don't cause epistaxis. It is forceful blowing of the nose or nose picking which leads to bleeding. But you should be aware of common causes for epistaxis. He also asked negative history, which about ear. Why did you ask for ear negative history?
Because
it might be by post-nasal. Okay, so any nasal complaint or any nasal disease can block the eustachian tube. Eustachian tube block can lead to spread of infection. First of all, it can lead to effusion of the middle ear. It can even lead to infection spreading to the ear. So we should always rule out any ear symptoms. Is it rightly what symptoms have you ruled out for ear?
No ear pain, no discharge, and no reduced hearing.
Yes, so these three symptoms, pain, discharge and reduced hearing, should always be asked in any nose complaint. Even if it is a tonsil patient, adenoid patient, throat and nose, any history, these three symptoms of ear should be always asked. That is ear pain, reduced hearing and discharge. In ear complaints, you ask for everything, but in a nose complaint, these three negative history should be there. Okay? Fine. Next, what about examination?
Examination of nose.
So generally in exam when you present, you have to also write or talk about general examination, systemic examination, but most likely examiner will cut you, stop and tell you to talk about nose examination. So how do you start nose examination?
External nose examination, no external deformity. Vestibule normal, on anterior rhinoscopy, caudal dislocation to the right.
Wait, so to start nose examination, we first start with the nose, external nose. We have to look for any external nasal deformity present or not. Are you aware of any deformity which can be there?
Saddle nose, crooked nose, mouth nose.
Okay, these are common deformities which can be there. You should be aware of causes for saddle nose. Anybody? Saddle nose causes?
Syphilis.
Okay, any granulomatous disease like syphilis, leprosy, tuberculosis, anything else?
Complication of septoplasty.
Of septoplasty, SMR, complication can be saddle nose. Post rhinoplasty patient can have saddle nose. So these can be causes. You should be aware of common external nasal deformities. Then second point we checked was?
Vestibule.
Vestibule. What is this vestibule?
Sir, external most, outermost part.
It is the skin lined part of the inner part of the nose. So the skin goes inside, or the hair bearing area in the nose is a vestibule, and its examination is important. Why?
To see for vestibulitis.
Why do you want, are you so interested in vestibulitis?
Allergic rhinitis patient.
No, what is so important for vestibulitis? Remember, vestibulitis, this infection from ear infection can directly spread to cavernous sinus in the brain through valveless venous connection. So it is always, any vestibulitis in the nose has to be aggressively treated. Third point is?
Anterior rhinoscopy.
Yes, now you take a headlight, you put a thudicum and then start doing anterior rhinoscopy examination. What are the findings?
Caudal dislocation to the right, anterior septum deviation to left, nasal mucosa.
What is this caudal dislocation?
At the back, there is septum is dislocated from the flute.
So how will it appear in the nose? So in the nose, when you do an anterior rhinoscopy, normally septum is midline and there are terminates on the side. If a patient suppose has a gross DNS, like this patient maybe has a DNS to left side. So he has a DNS and the caudal part is seen in the anteriorly. So the moment you lift the tip, you will see that patient does has a DNS on the left side. But the most innermost part, also called the caudal part of septum, is just seen prominent. Mostly when we lift the tip, we will see a prominent bulge in this center, in this part, which is the caudal dislocation, and the DNS would be on the left side. So if DNS on left side, mostly we see a caudal dislocation, or the caudal part of septum is dislocated on the right side. So this, I think this is the same finding in your patient.
Yes.
He has a caudal dislocation on right side and DNS on the left side. Remember, caudal dislocation is always seen on the side opposite to a DNS, especially in a C-shaped DNS. Okay, what else?
Nasal mucosa was minimally congested. Right side inferior turbinate hypertrophy. On cold spatula test.
Okay, so endoscopy always mention caudal dislocation is present. You mention about side of DNS. You mention about nasal mucosa, the type of nasal mucosa. You mention about the inferior turbinate. You also mention if patient has any secretions like mucoid secretions, mucoid discharge present or not present. And yes, in this case, patient has a DNS to left side. Whenever there is DNS to left side, there is more room on the right side. And that is why this air strikes on turbinate and this turbinate starts giving a hypertrophied appearance. This is called as paradoxical hypertrophy of turbinate. And so a C-shaped DNS can also cause bilateral nasal obstruction. Okay. Yes, then he said about cold spatula test. How do you do a cold spatula test? How do we do? Yes, very important. We tell the patient to breathe normally. It should not be a forceful breathe out. We want normal breathing. And what do we look for?
We
take a tongue depressor. We keep it below the nose of the patient, just above the upper lip, and tell him to breathe normally. And we look for mist formation. Ideally, there should be equal misting on both sides. In case of one side DNS, we may find reduced mist on the affected side. Okay, next.
Cold spatula test, reduced misting on left side. Sinus tenderness, tender left maxillary sinus.
Where do we check for sinus tenderness, for maxillary sinus?
Canine fossa.
So, and what about frontal sinus?
Medial
canthus. No.
Sir, lowermost margin of the orbit.
Orbit, so okay, so frontal,
below the eyebrow.
Okay, so maxillary sinus is at the canine fossa, so just lateral to the ala of the nose. This is the canine teeth, so we press by thumb on the canine fossa. This is for maxillary sinus. For frontal sinus, this is the eyebrow, the medial part of the eyebrow, just below that. So just below the medial part of the eyebrow, again with the thumb, we check for frontal sinus. For ethmoid sinus is the medial canthus, that is just medial to medial canthus. We press with index finger on the patient and look for ethmoid sinus. So maxillary sinus, frontal sinus and ethmoid sinus tenderness has to be checked. In this patient, what is there?
Tender left maxillary sinus.
So patient has a left maxillary sinus tenderness, which signifies?
Sinusitis.
Maxillary sinusitis. Why do we have such specific points of checking tenderness? Why not anywhere we can check?
The sinus is not
The sinus is present, the entire thing
the
is a sinus.
The bone is thin on that part.
Yes, we want to press on the thinnest part of the sinus so the periosteum can be stimulated and patient can have, and we can elicit pain. The thinnest part of sinus should be pressed. Okay, further.
Cottle's test. Cottle's test is positive on left side.
What is Cottle's test?
You pull the cheek of the affected side away from the nose. And we'll check if the patency improves, like the breathing improves.
And what do we see? And what does it signify if it improves?
Nasal valve obstruction.
Nasal valve. What is nasal valve? Okay, so this patient has a DNS on the left side. If we pull the cheek of this patient, as you rightly told, we pull the cheek on that side laterally. So when we pull the cheek outside, this area will become more roomy. So this area is the nasal valve area. Nasal valve is formed by tip of the inferior turbinate, part of the upper lower part of the upper lateral cartilage, which is the part of the nose. So lower part of the upper lateral cartilage and corresponding part of the septum. So these three structures, they form nasal valve. It is the narrowest area in the nasal cavity. And whenever the air passes, whenever we breathe, it is because of nasal valve that this air with turbulence goes all inside the nose. So nasal valve maintenance is very important. When we lateralize this and patient says his symptoms have improved, it means by surgery his breathing will improve. So it says that nasal valve area is affected, and if we operate, patient will have a better breathing. Okay, so bottle test is done. Then next,
posterior rhinoscopy. Excessive gag.
So even if your patient has excessive gag, you should attempt to do posterior rhinoscopy. If it is too much of gag, you can leave it, but then in exam always attempt to do excessive posterior rhinoscopy. When you put a posterior rhinoscope inside the mouth, you take a tongue depressor, rest the tongue and warm the posterior rhinoscopy mirror or dip in Sevlon and put inside the mouth just below uvula. What structures do we see?
Choana,
basal,
uvula, soft palate, torus tuberis, opening of eustachian tube, fossa rosemulla.
And important structure in nasal pharynx,
adenoids.
So we try to look for adenoids, choana, eustachian tube opening. These three are the most important structure: choana, adenoids, and eustachian tube opening. What else?
Oral cavity and head and neck examination.
Yes, even in nose case, you have to do complete. It's a long case, so always do oral cavity, head and neck examination, and ear evaluation. Any positive findings, you have to mention and speak about that in the exam. Those cases we'll discuss in further classes. Okay, so what is your diagnosis?
Diagnosis is deviated nasal septum to left side with chronic sinusitis.
What makes you say it is a sinusitis as well? What finding?
Because he has pain on the cavernous fossa.
So whenever you make a diagnosis, diagnosis is based upon history and examination. So on history, which point suggests it is sinusitis?
Tenderness on
history.
The
headache.
Headache more on left side
and
aggravated on rhinitis.
And one more symptom?
Relieved on analgesics.
Symptom one more?
Facial pain.
But is again headache, facial pain is sinusitis. Discharge? What kind of discharge?
Mucopurulent.
Yes, occasionally patient has mucopurulent discharge. So mucopurulent discharge, headache plus sinus tenderness. These three also add up to the finding of DNS. So diagnosis will be, you have to write complete diagnosis. Deviated nasal septum, C-shaped on the left side with chronic maxillary sinusitis. Which sinusitis you have to mention? So chronic maxillary sinusitis. So how do you manage?
Antihistamines.
Okay.
Antibiotics.
Okay. So whenever you are asked about management, you always talk of investigation and then treatment. So the first investigation that you do for sinusitis is?
X-ray.
You can do an X-ray paranasal sinus waters view. However, nowadays X-ray is not that important, so we send the patient for a CT scan paranasal sinus. It will tell us about all the sinuses present in the face and their involvement. And once the sinusitis is confirmed, how will you approach the patient? How will you treat? What surgery will you do? For DNS, we will do a septoplasty. And for sinusitis, what is surgery that we do? So for sinusitis, the most common surgery nowadays is FESS, that is functional endoscopic sinus surgery. In your book, there may be mentioned about cardial lung surgery, but nowadays we are done away. We don't do cardial lung surgery. We always do FESS, functional endoscopic sinus surgery. However, before taking the patient for FESS, we give the patient at least 3 to 4 weeks of antibiotics. And even after that, symptoms persist. In that case, we take up the patient for FESS. So when you talk of management, you say, I will investigate the patient by X-ray PNS or a CT scan PNS to look for the involvement of sinusitis. I will give a course of antibiotics for 3 to 4 weeks to the patient and look for symptomatic improvement. Ideally, a CT scan should be done after you have finished the course of medication. So give a course of medication. Then go for scan, and still if the symptom, if the symptoms and the sinus involvement is present in the scan, you take up the patient for surgery. If it is only DNS, you don't go for X-ray or CT scan, you just take up the patient for surgery. You can do either a septoplasty. Again, SMR is not done nowadays. Why?
Because it is not conservative as septoplasty.
So what can be the complications?
Deformation.
High chance of
saddle
nose and saddle nose and septal perforation can be there. Okay, so SMR can lead to more chances of complication, and those complications are less in case of septoplasty because it is a limited or conservative surgery. We just remove only the deviated part. FESS was functional endoscopic sinus surgery. You should be aware about complications of septoplasty. What is FESS? what are complications of FES, because it's one of the most common surgeries done nowadays. Okay, so this is how you will present a case of DNS or a nose case. Thank you so much.